Hey everybody, I hope that you've all had a great week, and I'm sure you've seen a lot of the news out there. There was some major news that went on this week, not just with the summit that went on in Singapore, which I'll get into in a little bit. We also made some great progress this week in the fight against the opioid epidemic, which very specifically plagues our community. We did a lot of work there by passing over 30 bills this week that address addiction, prevention, treatment, expanding research, curbing drug trafficking, and a lot more. We also passed two important bills that strengthen programs for returning veterans transitioning into the civilian workforce. Now, before I get into all of that legislative work for this week, I want to talk to you briefly about the issue that is on top of all of our minds. If you live in the Treasure Coast, in the Palm Beaches, in St. Lucie County, Martin County, Palm Beach County, the number one issue that I've been working on since I got here as a member of Congress is the discharges that we know are going to come out from Lake Okeechobee year after year. Now, we are beginning the third week of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers using our community, using my own backyard, your backyard, as their personal septic tank. And I don't think that that's hyperbole. I said it on the House floor yesterday. I think it's about as accurate description as what anybody could possibly say about what's going on. Lake Okeechobee is filled with runoff, with nutrients, and when they want to flush that toilet, they send it out to the Treasure Coast of Florida, and they destroy our environment, they destroy our economy, and they threaten the health of every single man and woman and child that comes anywhere near that water, comes in contact with the water, and very possibly may even be able to, if they breathe, some of the airborne pathogens that come off of the water. That's not something that's completely settled or not, but it's one of the things that we're asking to be looked into. And this is how it affects our community. Our beaches are closed. There's signs that say no swimming, say don't touch the water, hazard to human life, where the water is literally green, or where it's not green, it's black because it's so dirty. This toxic algae, the cyanobacteria, I've told everybody, this affects my life just as much as anybody else. When I fly home from Washington, D.C., usually when I'm in the car on the way back, my kids are asking me, they're saying, Dad, can you stop at the bait store and pick up some bait? Because what they like to do with me when I get home is they want to go fishing. And I usually fish off the dock because it's a little bit down, hard for me to get down in the water. But what they like to do is they like to shimmy down the rocks, go down and wade in the water and cast out themselves. That's how they like to go fishing. And I'll be standing up there on the dock watching them. They can't do that. We don't eat the fish that we pull out of the water. And it's been this way, not just for a couple weeks, but for decades. It's not humane. It's not equitable in the way that it affects everybody across the state of Florida. And we have taken some critical steps. I talked about them last week. We took some critical steps for the long term of preventing this from happening year after year when we passed that Water Resources and Development Act that included the one thing that we've been asking for several years, where so much of our community has been putting our blood, sweat, and tears looking to get that Southern Storage EAA, that reservoir for Lake Okeechobee, so we could send that water in the south direction instead of out towards our backyard, working to get that done. We got the placeholder for that to get done here at the federal level. That was incredibly important. And we got a secured commitment to begin the process for a Lake Okeechobee regulation schedule review for that to begin in 2019, so that the Corps of Engineers will take a much better look at the levels at which that they can keep Lake Okeechobee in times of heavy rain, so they don't send that water out to our backyard. They keep that water on the lake where it belongs, or send it south where it belongs. Don't send it towards our epicenter of human population, where it's hurting our families, where it's affecting our health, where it's killing our economy. And earlier in the year, we fully funded all of the repairs to the Herbert Hoover Dyke, so that those repairs to the Herbert Hoover Dyke could get done that much quicker. It's going to be done in all likelihood several years in advance of what it was otherwise going to be completed. These were some really important steps, but I know that we need the help today. We need the help yesterday. We need the help 2 weeks ago. We're worried right now about our children coming in contact with toxic water. We're worried right now about the business owners where I go and say, hey, listen, I need to buy some bait because I'm going to go out with my kids, about them having to close their door. We're worried about every corner of our environment, whether we're on the North Fork of the river or the South Fork of the river, whether we're over on Sewell's Point, whether we're down in Jupiter or wherever. This is something that affects every single one of us, whether you're up in Fort Pierce and you're thinking about the discharge coming out of Taylor Creek or somewhere else. It doesn't matter. We're all affected by this. You know, and I told some folks on the House floor earlier this week, I said, I was a soldier in the U.S. Army. And just like those men and women that are in the Army Corps of Engineers, I have to think that there's some common ground between us in the way that we want to go out there and protect others. I was willing to give my life to protect my country and to protect my community. And I have to believe that they can't stand idly by while they put the human lives at risk in our community. You think about the long-term health effects of what can go on with coming in contact with this cyanobacteria and this toxic algae. I wouldn't sacrifice the health of any community in the name of what might happen sometime in the future. That's the reality, and that's what I said on the floor of the House of Representatives, because it's the truth. We can't leave a fallen comrade when we're in combat, and as members of the military, we can't stand idly by and leave one community to die at the hands of the federal government. And this is the fight that I'm having here day in and day out. I'm having it with the Corps of Engineers. I'm having it with Fish and Wildlife. I'm having it with FEMA. I'm having it with the EPA. I'm having it on every single front that I can have it, because the reality is they all play a specific role in this. And there's fights to be had with every single one of them. That's why I called the Corps of Engineers. I said, you got to stop these discharges immediately. You know that the water that you're sending us is dirty. It's toxic. And until you can say that there is no toxic presence in that water, until the Corps of Engineers can say there is no risk to human life, to the health of your children, there's no risk to mothers out there, there's no risk to any father out there who comes in contact with the water, until the Corps of Engineers can say that, they have no business whatsoever even considering sending that water into our backyard. It is not right. And as I said before, this isn't hyperbole. And I would invite them every single day, if you think it's okay, then you come down here with your children and expose your families to what it is that our families are exposed to. You know, the Fish and Wildlife, their job is to go out there and protect endangered animals. We have endangered animals too in our nationally recognized estuary. We have manatee that live in our water, and they need to be kept safe as well. We have waterfowl that no longer shows up in our area because there's no fish for them to go out there and eat. If it's good enough for all of these other agencies to recognize in other places, it has to be good enough for them to recognize in our community as well. I want to switch gears a minute to some of the other work that we've done here in Washington, D.C. this week. I think you can understand my frustration on this issue. I could probably speak about this for a straight hour without taking a breath, because it frustrates me as much as anybody. But I want to get to some good news as well. This week, the administration took some historic first step toward the pathway towards a safer, a more secure, a more peaceful world. And I want to say thank you to the administration for their maximum pressure policies and the intensive sanctions regime that have been put on the Kim regime in North Korea. Now, I sit on the Committee of Foreign Affairs, and I sit on the Subcommittee of Counterproliferation and Terrorism. These are things that I pay a great deal of attention to. And the reality is the Kim regime had no choice but to come to the table and agree to work towards complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. This is right after we saw North Korea and South Korea taking historic moves to end their war that never ended between the two of them. There is a lot of great things that are going on that peninsula that are making the world a better place. The agreement between President Trump and Chairman Kim included not only a shared commitment towards a lasting and stable peace in the Korean Peninsula, But also, one of the most important things that I could say that touches me very personally as somebody that goes out to Arlington National Cemetery regularly, I see the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, I see the guards. One of the things that hasn't been talked about is that the remains of prisoners of war and those missing in action, those are going to be repatriated to the United States of America and identified. We're talking about the Department of Defense estimates nearly 8,000 American personnel are still unaccounted for from the Korean War, which means that this is a significant show of humanitarian reciprocity to have the remains of those thousands and thousands of service members who had never returned to the U.S., to have them return to their American families who just want to know what happened to their loved one. It's an important thing to our country to have those remains returned, to have our men and women brought back from overseas. It's a commitment that we make. I said it already in another context, but it is a commitment that we make. We don't leave our men behind. We don't leave a fallen comrade. So overall, this is a promising first step, and now we need to keep the maximum pressure on to ensure that North Koreans follow through on the work that's been going on this week. On a domestic front, we literally passed dozens of bills this week to tackle the opioid epidemic, which has continued to devastate communities across the country. Drug overdose, it's the leading cause of death for people under 50 in the United States, more than 115 people dying every day due to opioid-related ER deaths. In Florida, this increased nearly 100% in the decade between 2005 and 2014. Now, I know there's no easy solutions to this epidemic, but this week we made some major progress by passing about 30 bills to secure the necessary resources to support and reverse this disgusting trend that affects anybody in our community. You talk to any one of our law enforcement officers in our community, and they could tell you story after story after story about what they're seeing day in and day out. Our bills take important steps to empower our healthcare workforce, to improve addiction treatment and prevention, to expand research into the opioid epidemic, to stem the flow of illegal opioids flowing into our country from countries like China and other places, to get excess and unused medications out of circulation, and study alternative paths towards pain treatment so that people don't get addicted to these opioid medications, and a whole lot more. You can read about all of that on my website. And I want to tell you all something personally about this. This touches me personally as well. You know, when I woke up in Walter Reed Army Medical Center after my injury, I woke up on a laundry list of medications. Now, prior to losing two legs and a finger, I'd never had a surgery aside from maybe having my tonsils out when I was about 3-4 years old. I'd never had any surgeries in my life. I never broke any bones. It wasn't a part of me. When I woke up in Walter Reed Army Medical Center, I must have been on 20 different drugs that I'd never imagined being on before. I had an epidural, I had a dilaudid drip, I had oral morphine and oxys, I had heavy sleep sedatives, antidepressants, anti-inflammatories, you name it, a list of things that I never imagined being on in my life. And from the moment that I woke up, it was a priority to me to wean myself off of those medications as quickly as possible. I started asking those doctors immediately, what do you have me on and why do you have me on this? Okay, you have me on an antidepressant. I get that you're trying to keep something from happening here, but I'm not depressed. Take that away from me. I don't want to be addicted. And I started working on that immediately. And it took about 6 months to wean off of all of these drugs that they had me on. And the one thing that I can say about this was to go from the lowest amount of those narcotics that they had me on, I think it was an oral morphine, I had to take it at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m., to go from that last smallest amount to getting to nothing, it was difficult. It was painful. I would wake up in the morning at 3 a.m. like I had 5 pots of coffee, and you know, my food would run through me, and you know, I was moody and I was angry, and there was a lot of other things that were going on. I get the painful piece that goes on with this, and you know, so in that, it's something that does touch very close to home. So in that, I want to talk about the last thing that I'd like to bring up about this week. I want to mention two more bills that we passed this week that are especially important and really very personal to me. I know the struggles that many men and women go through when they're returning home from service. I just talked about some of that when I came home from service injured. Now, it's not easy, and many veterans, they do face difficult, often crippling mental health challenges, physical challenges, post-traumatic stress issues, substance abuse issues, and it makes it very difficult to return to civilian life. That's why this week we passed two bills to increase the VA staff for programs that are supporting returning veterans. First, the Veterans Treatment Court Improvement Act of 2018. It's going to require the VA to hire at least 50 more VJO or Veterans Justice Outreach Specialists so that the veteran treatment courts have the resources that they need to provide effective and specialized treatment to the veterans in need. This program, it was designed to address symptoms that are unique to veterans alongside a presiding judge and a veterans justice outreach specialist. It's a unique program that's meant to establish a rehabilitation program tailored to those needs of the veteran that comes home in a situation like that. Now, another successful VA program is the peer-to-peer counseling program, which provides support to our female veterans, especially those who have suffered sexual trauma while serving in the military and are now struggling with post-traumatic stress or are at risk for homelessness. Our nation's female veteran population, it's increasing. And a VA report, which is frankly pretty alarming, found that female veterans are at a two and a half times higher risk of suicide than any other adult female. We have to do more to address the need of women returning from service as well, which is why our bill, the Peer-to-Peer Act, it directs the VA to increase the number of peer-to-peer counselors for female veterans to ensure that this critical program has the sufficient counselors needed to give all of our veterans the mental health services that they need. Our service members, they put the uniform on every day. They're happy to do the jobs that they're asked to do. They volunteer to do the jobs they're asked to do, no matter how dangerous they are. When they come home, it's our duty to serve them in the exact same way that they served us, especially when they find themselves in times of need. We can and we must do more for those veterans struggling with the difficult challenges of returning home. But these bills, they're great steps towards giving returning veterans the support they need as they face these challenges. I'm very proud of these pieces of legislation. As I said already, in a few previous videos, I'm very proud to be a member of the Committee on Veterans Affairs, where I get to go out there and represent my fellow veteran. And I think we're going to be able to get a lot of great work done on that committee. With that, as I always tell you, it's an honor to represent you here in Congress, and I hope that you all have a great rest of your week. I'll look forward to seeing y'all around home this weekend.